Go to our next panel, which is looking at global health crises and child survival. Our first speaker is Dr. Nils. Oh, let me say before I get to the panel that for your pronunciation guide, should there be one, it's Dr. Osterholm. I had mispronounced it, and my apologies. Dr. Nils Dalar is President and CEO of the Global Health Council, the world's largest membership alliance of public health professionals and organizations working in over 100 low-income countries, dedicated to raising attention, resources, and knowledge needed to improve health worldwide. Neff Walker is a senior project officer in the strategic information section of UNICEF. He works on economic modeling in terms of costs of health interventions for children. He's the co-author of a very, very interesting paper that was published a number of months ago in Lancet on the economics of child survival. Dr. Jeffrey Griffiths is a public health and infectious diseases physician with many years of international and domestic experience, focus on waterborne diseases, AIDS, malnutrition-related infections, and Colleen Hardy is a field epidemiologist with the International Rescue Committee. She has worked all over the world. The IRC is a non-government organization. She's worked all over the world, and she was most recently where we actually spoke, I think, in New Orleans and Louisiana. So let me ask Nils if you'll come up and start us. Oh, you may stay there if you choose.
We rearranged the panel for actually the camera, so that people could center themselves on either side of the
podium.
That was great.
Steve, come on up. You can.
And
while we're doing some housekeeping here, again, I invite the people in the back of the room, precariously trying to balance things on your knee. I point out to you the public health risk of spilling coffee.
And then we can have a couple of people sitting on this side. Oh, I'm so sorry.
Well, I'll just keep standing until it's worked out.
You're fine. Yeah,
You're here because you report news, and certainly what we just heard from the first panel in terms of avian flu, H5N1, has become newsworthy, even though, interestingly, it's the kind of thing that Mike and many of us in the community have been worried about and talking about internally for the past decade or so. I have some news for you. From the time that we got in here this morning to now, over 2,000 people died acutely. And the projections are that what caused those 2,000 deaths will take 170 million lives over the next 10 years. Now, that sounds like news, but in fact, it's the wallpaper that Nanda was talking about, or what I like to refer to as the carrier wave of global health for those in the broadcast media. This is the death toll from infectious and reproductive causes that takes place every single year. 17 million people die every year. Almost 11 million of them are children under the age of 5. They're dying from common, easily treatable, easily preventable, cheap infectious diseases. They're dying from inadequate reproductive health care for women and for their newborns. And the striking thing is that as our attention rightfully turns to these acute outbreaks, which I would call the loud signal on our carrier wave, it's the carrier wave itself, this underlying situation of ill health and death, that promotes and supports and accentuates the acute risks when they occur. We all recognize the homily that if you are bothered by mosquitoes and you're living next to a swamp, you don't want a bigger swatter, you want to drain the swamp. Well, when we look at what's going on in terms of disease outbreaks around the world, where are those disease outbreaks generally originating? They're originating in poor communities, either in urbanized megacities around the developing world, or in the areas where livestock and people are in very intense contact, as they are in Southeast Asia. But those diseases don't have to leap if we had adequate healthcare services. Again, I'll stress at very low cost, and we'll be hearing more about that from Neff coming up. I want to focus on the issue of the children under the age of five. As I said, there are almost 11 million deaths, 10.7 million deaths a year, and those 2,000 deaths that occurred since we sat down here are that's just that number divided by the number of minutes that we've been here. Every 3 seconds, a child dies. And what are they dying from? They're dying from pneumonia. They're dying from diarrhea. They're dying of neonatal causes, things that occur in the first days of life. They're dying of malaria. To a much smaller extent, even though the last big signal that we received in terms of news in the global health arena has been AIDS, there are some who die of AIDS, but it's only about 3% of all child deaths. So it's not what we'd consider to be a major contributor. So here we are in this situation of a chronic, ongoing set of issues which nobody's paying attention to. I don't know when the last time was that I read a newspaper or magazine article about child deaths, because it's accepted as the background, as the wallpaper. A lot of us working through the RX for Survival program and the campaign that's being built around that are looking to change that. And you can see what kinds of changes are possible in the context of global health when you look back 10 years and consider what was going on in the arena of HIV and AIDS. 10 years ago, the United States was devoting about $120 million a year to addressing AIDS globally. And for years, through the 1990s, that level stayed flat. And then finally, some people in this room, I saw Steve Sternberg, here he is, started writing about these issues. USA Today, New York Times, Washington Post started writing about AIDS, and it started catching attention, and this chronic background problem became suddenly newsworthy and acute. Now, AIDS is very well worth covering. AIDS kills 3 million people a year. That's about a third of the death toll among children from these infectious causes, but certainly in an order of magnitude that deserves attention. It infects another 5 million a year, so we're getting more into the pool than we're losing from the pool, and it's growing. And it is certainly the biggest pandemic that we've faced in the last three-quarters of a century, since the Spanish flu pandemic in 1918-1919. In AIDS, finally, because of reporting, these issues started getting political salience. And as a result of getting political salience, policymakers here in Washington and in Geneva and Brussels and all around the world started really paying attention. And today, rather than $120 million a year from the U.S. budget being spent on global AIDS, we're up to close to $3 billion a year. Now, during that same time period, child health, the programs that the United States supports addressing child health and child survival issues, has stayed nearly flat. If you take inflation and the growth in the number of children in the world because of population growth into consideration, we're actually spending a little bit less today than we were 10 years ago on child health. And yet we have all of these terrific interventions that could save lives today at a fraction of the cost. And I'll contrast this with what Mike was talking about, Mike Osterholm, with the where we are with pandemic H5N1, where we are years away from a response. That doesn't mean we shouldn't be doing it. It means that it takes a long time. It's like asking the civil engineers or the engineers who build the dikes for the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, when Hurricane Katrina was sort of moving into the coast, if they could do something to protect New Orleans. At that point, all they could do was tell people to get to higher ground. And in some respects, if H5N1 explodes this year, we're in a very similar situation. We're not ready to deal with it. But if we're lucky and this one becomes latent or it doesn't take off, then we have the time to develop the infrastructure that Mike was talking about. Well, that infrastructure, to come back to my initial point, that infrastructure has to start in the countries where diseases are emerging and where the health conditions are the worst if we're going to have a hope of impacting the speed of spread of global infectious diseases. You don't wait until it's spread through 50 cities of more than 10 million people and 75 countries with average incomes of less than $2 per person per year to then begin, because it's finally the first case has gotten to the United States. You begin in the field with basic healthcare programs that develop surveillance so that people can start seeing disease, and also to provide basic care services so that there is a response, even if it's not a high-tech response, there's a response capability that's already built in. You can't do that on an emergency basis. You cannot do it with the idea that you build a whole system for something that's exceptional. We can't build a global system in the villages and slums of the third world to deal with avian influenza, because until people start experiencing it, that simply doesn't drive a system. They experience child deaths, the deaths of women in pregnancy and childbirth, and HIV/AIDS every single day in these countries. And so that's the basis on which you can build, construct, and support a program that's going to work around the world for their benefit and for the benefit of all the rest of us. Thank you.
It's interesting because I don't want to guess what the other people are going to say, but I think what you're hearing from Niels and also from me is really it's the argument about routine versus exceptional, that basically what we had in the earlier presentation was this idea of an exceptional event that is going to occur again, and it may produce catastrophic numbers of deaths of hundreds of millions globally, and what we're doing to prepare for that rare event, which will occur at some point in the future, versus the routine that happens every day. As Neil was laying out, that the idea is that millions of kids globally, 10.6, 10.7 million children a year under the age of five, die of routine diseases that are easily avoidable. One of the things, I'm just going to, one little story that was cute for me, that I worked in and still do officially UNAIDS. And our job was doing estimates of the pandemic, how many people globally had HIV/AIDS, how many people had died since the start of the epidemic. And one of the things happened about 2001 with great fanfare, the head of UNAIDS and also other people picked it up, that they made the argument that HIV/AIDS was the greatest pandemic, the greatest epidemic in the history of mankind. It had now killed more people than any other epidemic since the start of the AIDS epidemic, because they were comparing it to Spanish flu, and at that point people said roughly 20 million people had died, and the estimate was that AIDS by 2002 had killed roughly 22 million people. But the interesting thing is to think about during the time period when AIDS first appeared in 2002, about 20-something years, how many people died of diarrhea? How many children under age five died of diarrhea? Well, actually, almost 10 million more kids have died of diarrhea during that period than had died of AIDS, the world's greatest epidemic of all time. How many kids had died of pneumonia? 20 million more kids had died of pneumonia during that same time period. The idea is, what's a pandemic? What's an epidemic? The issue is not how you label it, but looking at causes of death and what can we do about it. So one of the, I don't want to say that was the cause, but I think lots of people who work in child survival started talking about the idea of public health is what we're trying to do is convince people that this is something that the world should respond to. Because often the difficulty in countries is lack of income, or excuse me, lack of resources to address these issues. As an outgrowth of that, I think there was a whole series of work that led up to the Bellagio series in Lancet that talked about child survival, what were the major killers, what were the interventions, the routine interventions that could be brought to bear on this, and talking about basically their findings that were routine interventions, nothing that we have to know the genome about, nothing that we have to have a Gates Global Grand Challenge to study for, that simply providing simple preventive and treatment options could in fact reduce the number of under five deaths by two-thirds if they were applied globally. Now, the work I got invited here for was simply we tried to look at how much would this cost if you were going to do that, if you were going to scale up and reduce 6 million child deaths a year, roughly how much would it cost? And we'll hear a question later that brings it up, but I'll go ahead and address it. What we were looking at is, well, what does it cost to treat diarrhea? What does it cost to treat pneumonia? And what we tried to argue is that you can take very simple interventions, and if they were scaled up, would it be very expensive to save 6 million lives? And in fact, what we ended up claiming, and I think it is true, that for $5 billion a year, you could reduce child mortality by two-thirds, that you could save 6 million lives a year. These interventions are very simple. Again, as I think I've made the point again, oral rehydration therapy is easy. Providing zinc or vitamin A is easy. Immunizing more children is easy. Antibiotics is easy. Routine things that we accept as kind of part of our natural, kind of, I want to say, divine right if you live in a wealthy country. That's really denied to many people of the world and many children. So the idea in our paper, we simply were just trying to make one more link in the step of saying, can we actually save these 6 million lives a year? Yes. We know the interventions, they're there. Is it going to be so expensive that we can't do it? And in fact, we tried to argue that, no, it's not too expensive. It basically works out to about $1.25 per head, per capita, of the countries where those children die. That's not a lot of money. And just to end, we did a really bad thing one day. When we looked at our cost of how much money we were asking, we started saying, well, I wonder what that $5 billion compares to. And it got rather embarrassing. You'd say, well, do we spend more money on dog food in the U.S.? Yes. Do we spend more money on bottled water? Yes. In fact, while $5 billion sounds like a lot of money, on the global scale, or even in the U.S., it's not very much money when you think about 6 million lives. But again, it's also not very interesting. Diarrhea is not going to mutate and become a global pandemic that's going to threaten the U.S., but it is a routine issue that affects millions of people in the world that we don't seem to be able to market very well because I firmly believe if we could market it better, and I know that sounds bad, but I think that is what public health is partly about, is marketing priorities. If we could market it better, I find it hard to believe that the world couldn't respond with $5 billion to save that many lives. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Jeff Griffiths from Tufts University. What we've heard so far this particular session is we've heard a bit about the ethical imperative to address these diseases, these routine diseases that kill so many children around the world. And we've just heard a monetary argument that basically the cost of doing this is a drop in the bucket. And it's I've heard a colleague of mine describe it as my cup of coffee a week. You know, that's basically what we're talking about. So we're talking about relatively small amounts of money to affect something that's really huge. On page 23, I believe, of the little thing that you got, which is this little booklet. No, no, not that. Sorry.
Another little thing.
Yeah, this one right here, this global health stuff. If you look on page 23, you see a little pie chart there. And the little pie chart's actually got, like, how many kids are croaking from this. And you'll see that the numbers there are really big for, again, these routine things like pneumonia, for diarrhea, et cetera, which we don't really tend to think about. I'd like to actually throw a little curve into this and basically say, how far are we in the United States from being a developing country? And I'd like to say that that distance is very, very small. In 1900, most people in this country lived to about an average age of in the 40s. Now we live into the 70s. So we've had a 30-year increase in lifespan. And if you look at that 30 years, a good 20 of it are due to three things. And we're not talking, you know, really high-tech stuff. We're talking clean water, we're talking about clean food, and we're talking about vaccines. Everything else tends to fall away from the sides. So when you look at things like clean water and clean food, we're talking about keeping poop out of our food and water. You know, this is not real complicated stuff. And we're talking about using a really cheap technology like vaccines. 100 years ago, people understood this. People in Boston were willing to give up 3% of their income per year to get clean water. In 1900, 10% of infants under the age of one died from infantile diarrhea every summer. That's the same thing that these people die of. We are very close to being a developing world country. We're only about 100 years down the pike. If it wasn't for water treatment and the fact that we don't allow poop into our food, we'd really be toast. If you look at something like Katrina, what's happened is it's very interesting. We have these, you know, terrible events, and many of the lessons that we are bringing to bear in terms of how to deal with a disaster like Katrina are basically the lessons that some of us learn every day and we practice in the developing world where these things are going on. I'm sure we're going to be hearing more about that from Colleen Hardy. This business of that distance being very short comes through in many different ways. One of them, for example, is not only that we have just a couple of barriers that keep us from having these terrible diseases happen here. Think about what's happened in terms of the public health infrastructure. It's been hollowed out over the last 25 years. I do a lot of waterborne disease work. And you might think, oh, well, we don't have to worry about that in the United States now, do we? Well, that's drivel. We do. And if you talk to the people at the CDC, they will say, well, you know, we had 18 epidemics that we investigated last year. And if you ask the question, why was it 18? Why was it not 42? And why was it not 13? The answer that's the real answer is, that's all the money that we had the money to investigate. It's not because there's not more of them out there. We just have a hollowed out system of reporting and monitoring and things like that. And when you think about the public health system, we now run things as if we're a factory. What do you do if you're a business? You run a system at the average amount of output that you need. You don't have excess capacity. You get rid of it. What happens when you get hit with avian flu? You need excess capacity. We're going to have all these sick people, and we've got to put them in a hospital, or we've got to put them someplace else. We don't have that. We've gotten rid of them all. We don't have that. What happened in New Orleans? Where did we have facilities for people who were sick? We didn't. Basically, all the capacity's gone. So our whole approach in many ways is one where we've become very comfortable with this idea that we don't have these problems. Poverty alleviation is a really big deal. It's amazing what it will do for people. There was a study that just came out in The Lancet showing that 52% of pneumonias in little kids could be prevented if people had soap to wash their hands. Now, you've got to be pretty poor not to have soap. What's one of the reasons why young teenage girls in Africa have sex with older men? And acquire HIV, they don't have the money to do things like buy soap, and they need things like that. In the United States, what was it that got rid of malaria? Everyone tells you that what it was we started treating people with anti-malarials after World War II. We drained the swamps. Nah, the old malariologists tell us it was poverty alleviation, but they didn't use those words. What was it? We had TV sets. People didn't sit on the front porch anymore, get bitten by mosquitoes. They sat inside. And what else did they have? They had screens. Screens came in after World War II. People could afford screens when they hadn't been able to afford it beforehand. So, you know, we tell ourselves stories about how distant we are from the developing world circumstance, and I don't think that's really the case. I think we're very close to it. And we have a very, very fragile system. One of the things that was talked about earlier was the sort of hollowing out of the public health system, but this the way that we've got international commerce, for example, you know, it's all just in time and so forth. There's no capacity for things. That same thing really comes through in a lot of what we deal with. Having made the viewpoint that we're very close to a developing world country and that it's just our richness of the moment that allows us not to worry about that, it's very hard then not to look at people in other places and say, why shouldn't I care that there's 11 million kids who died? I think there's such a powerful ethical argument for this that it's really incumbent upon us to think through what does it mean if we ignore it. And I think I'll stop with that.
Thank you. It was just recently pointed out to me that Katrina is old news, and perhaps it is, but I think it might be a wake-up call for us in developing strategies to address certain things like avian flu and child health. On September 4th, the International Rescue Committee arrived on the ground in Baton Rouge, and it was a new kind of experience for IRC because we don't actually respond domestically. And we went there expecting business as usual. We went down there expecting a large coordination body, a forum in which you could share information and fill the gaps. We quickly realized that it wasn't business as usual. In my experience internationally, you arrive on the ground, you find ways to go to the coordination meetings and health sector meetings, in my case, whether in Darfur or in Aceh, Indonesia, during the tsunami response. Although not perfect, it worked, and it is a forum for all players on the ground, the government agencies, non-government agencies, faith-based organizations, and even U.S. military, Japan, Germany, et cetera, in the sense of the tsunami response. There are definitely rivalries in any response, and it's very inevitable, but it's a way that everybody comes together and shares this information. Major issues are discussed, and gaps are identified, and one becomes aware more or less of the real situations on the ground. I became aware that it wasn't so clear in the Katrina response when a government agency called me, a local government agency, and asked me to explain this bacterial disease that's affecting some of the population. I was a bit concerned that there wasn't a forum for people to discuss this bacterial disease and directed them to the CDC. Seeing this larger forum didn't exist, IRC decided to do what we normally do and try to tap into the local information, the local people that are working on the ground, to try to explain who's in charge and who are the players. It was brought up to me that these people who are there on the ground are those at the end of the day that are going to have to take responsibility, but they're the ones that don't make the decisions. It would be unfair, actually, to say that there wasn't any coordination taking place because there were lots of parallel systems that were duplicating the same things. There were lots of assessments going on. And, in fact, we decided, because of lack of information, that we would also take upon it and do an assessment. And we would look at education, psychosocial care, public health, and protection. In the meantime, we also realized that while we were developing this assessment tool to analyze the situation, there was also a larger assessment that was about to take place. So through discussions and talking, we decided that we would reduce our public health assessment and go along with the education part, protection, and the psychosocial. I inserted myself in the larger assessment that was taking place in Baton Rouge to realize that the shelters that we were actually going to assess were not part of this larger assessment. I was told by a bunch of doctors that they were getting ready to go home because there was nothing for them to do. Yet on the same day, I was asked by a doctor in a facility if I could please give information on how to actually get more healthcare staff to help with assistance in the facility. Usually, in conflict settings, you have a lot of good intentioned people descending on the area. And for some reason, in conflict, in disasters, you have more of this than in the conflict. And it's about understanding the roles and understanding the drill. Unfortunately, in Katrina, there wasn't a place for people to actually fit into the system. The assessment started, and we quickly realized that this multi-sectoral assessment, which would try to conceptualize and analyze the current needs of those displaced, were not really being used for decision-making. As an epidemiologist, I use data to make decisions and to help me actually address a situation. And it quickly became apparent that a lot of these assessments, and you have to remember that the IRC assessment as well as this other larger assessment was one of many. It came to my attention that the primary objective of some of these assessments was not for decision making, but for another reason. IRC tried to do what we usually do internationally, and we try to look at the bigger picture. We try to take into considerations of local politics, cross-cultural issues, and look at pre-existing issues, such as poverty, to develop our decision. We could have done better, and we could have involved more of the local people and involved people from New Orleans. In the larger assessment that I was on, it was a quick wake-up call when we were asked by several people in the facility for information, and that everybody on the team was from out of state. Another issue that was highlighted during this assessment was the lack of standards in providing assistance, U.S. versus international. Wherever we have a number of internationally recognized guidelines for providing basic needs to the beneficiaries in terms of water and food, people are pretty much were generally taken care of in Katrina. However, as I visited a handful of shelters, I was amazed that sanitation conditions were definitely below international standards. In the early days of the emergency phase, in Darfur, for example, construction of latrines started and water systems began immediately. And we could gauge on how we were doing, and this was based on internationally accepted benchmarks. I did not expect to see latrines being constructed in Katrina. However, I did expect perhaps someone bringing in toilets and showers. For example, in the emergency stage, internationally, 20 people per latrine is recognized to be acceptable. However, I visited a handful of facilities where there were over 40 people per toilet and no showers at all. I was a bit concerned on who was guiding the outstanding community leaders who were yesterday's church ministers and who are today's facility managers trying to do their best to provide the basic needs. I wondered during my 3 weeks in Baton Rouge what lessons we have learned from international responses. And again, I point out that they're not perfect, but they do work. We have learned a lot of lessons from previous crises, and in order to help best assistance with all the players on the ground, I expected to see something much different, something even more sophisticated in the U.S. However, I think our system may have been too sophisticated that we left out the most vulnerable. I went to several shelters where people asked about information, and yet there was tons of printed information and everything on the web. And yet we failed to forget that a lot of people from New Orleans had only a third grade reading level. This really makes you think, and if it's a test of our response, I think we, as someone pointed out in Baton Rouge, we may have received a D. I think we could have learned a lot from the experiences in dealing with the large population displacements, which we do overseas, as seen in Katrina, but not including those important players that do have the experience of working overseas only exacerbated the situation. In closing, I'd like to say that I'm often critical of our response, not only the International Rescue Committee, but as part of the international community, in our responses overseas. But after participating during the first 3 weeks of Katrina, I have to say that I think that we are doing a good job overseas.
go to questions for any of our speakers over there. We're going to need a mic, so hang on. And please identify yourself as you speak, or before you speak.
Morning, Maggie Fox with Reuters. I want to ask you guys if any of you can go so far as to say if we solve some of these global health problems involving children and developing nations, how far will it go towards preventing situations like pandemic flu? Can we do that very specifically?
Let me start on that. As Mike Osterholm pointed out, the likelihood, the probability of another pandemic influenza is one. It's not that we will prevent one from happening, but the reality is that by having basic healthcare infrastructure and early response capability built on the back of basic services for children and mothers, the response can take place early. The explosive nature of the ignition point of the next influenza pandemic will be greatly muted. The world will have much more time to respond effectively, and the whole thing can be dampened significantly. And I'd say that it's not that we'll prevent it from happening altogether, it's that we will greatly mitigate the impact, both on the people who are being served by these programs and on the rest of the globe.
I think another good example of that is HIV/AIDS. People understood the pandemic of HIV/AIDS was beginning in the 80s, and people identified strategies that could have been used to decrease the size of the pandemic, the number of people that were affected by it, and to a great extent we ignored that. And HIV/AIDS is a major problem throughout the world, obviously. I work in a part of Kenya where a third of all the pregnant women who come in to deliver have HIV. I wonder what would have happened 10 or 15 years ago if we had been a little bit better about messages about preventing transmission, if we had instituted some of the other measures. And so I think that while flu may be a one, I'd just like to reinforce the point that it can be a one that can be a small one as opposed to a large one if we take care of things like this.
Any other comments from the panel? Got a question in the back there. Go ahead, dude. Hang on. For the TV thing, you got to.
Ben Harder with Science News. I have a question for Dr. Griffiths, in particular about your comment that money was the limiting factor in, for example, the CDC's investigation of waterborne outbreaks. I had the opportunity to actually report from inside that unit of the CDC for time, and what they told me and what they told each other was that it was also one factor was also the lack of invitations from state and local health authorities. By the same token, when the SARS outbreak occurred, international epidemiologists had great difficulty ground-truthing their data in China. So my question is, if money were no issue for epidemiology, how would we go about combating territorialism and lack of access?
Well, that's a really large issue. Just to pick up on your point and perhaps come up with an answer, when you look at the United States, we have 50 different states, we have a number of territories, and they are at very different levels of readiness in terms of either doing surveillance in their state, monitor disease there, and to feed information into the national system, which we assume is getting good information at the CDC. But many of the states are in critical shape. You know, they're on last legs when it comes to the public health infrastructure. We've seen a lot of money go towards bioterrorism events and concerns along those lines, and at the same time, standard things that would be helpful during the flu pandemic have been relatively starved for dollars. I don't know how to combat territorialism unless you say that we're all in this together and you come up with an ethos that's along those lines. But I think that many people in public health believe that, and that if you were able to remove some of the resource constraints, I think people could do a far better job in terms of what they are doing. You know, the CDC investigates outbreaks of waterborne disease. if you, you know, Congress mandated that the CDC was supposed to come up with the EPA for an estimate of how much waterborne disease there is on a chronic basis, if you will, not the epidemic of flu, but the chronic deaths from measles, malaria, blah, 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 et cetera, that we've been hearing about. So that sort of chronic stuff that's there. We still don't have one. We don't know how to estimate how much chronic waterborne disease there is in the United States. And it probably is far larger than epidemic disease. We just don't have the infrastructure in place. We have a system that's very good at taking care of cholera. We have a system that's oriented towards pandemic flu. We don't have a system that's received the same kind of attention when it comes to the expected endemic stuff. And I don't necessarily have an answer for you about how to combat that.
Actually, let me ask a follow-up question on that. Are you saying we don't have the infrastructure at the local level to feed into the federal level? I mean, what would cure that problem?
We need more attention to routine surveillance and monitoring. There are some states that do have resources for doing that, but most states do not have the resources to do a good job. If there's a small outbreak of some waterborne disease in many states, it won't be investigated by the local authorities because they simply don't have the time and et cetera, or the resources. They may have another issue. Don't forget our public health system now is not only dealing with these things, it's also dealing with minor problems like HIV/AIDS, smallpox preparation, worrying about influenza, et cetera. And so if it's not reported at the local level, it's not going to get reported at the national level.
Can I just follow up on that and take that to the global level as well? The basic premise of any sort of monitoring and reporting system has got to be that you can then do something about it. Nobody will ever report on things that the reports disappear, there's no action taken, which is why it's virtually impossible to get good reporting from slums and villages in the developing world, because so what if there's a disease outbreak? Nobody is there then responding to it. That's why in order to get good information, we have to have good basic services. It's not so much of a problem in the United States, but it's a critical element of a global surveillance and monitoring system if we're dealing with where these diseases are emerging.
Phil Musgrove from Health Affairs. An offhand observation, then a question for Neff Walker. The observation, I used to be a physicist, or was going to be one, and what I keep hearing about this routine versus special sounds like a difference between velocity and acceleration. You can't feel velocity no matter how fast you're going. All you can feel is force, and that goes with acceleration, even if it's very, very small, which is why you feel riding on the metro more than you feel riding in an airplane that's going 10 times as fast. What you're all describing is the need to measure speed and not just the jolts that we get from time to time. The specific question is this: since you're doing economic modeling anyway, and since several of you have made the point about not having enough excess capacity, why doesn't somebody do the same kind of sophisticated exercise that electric utilities go through all the time, which is asking how much excess capacity makes economic sense? What's the cost of maintaining an extra 10%, 20%, 50%? What's the likely variation through time of the demand for electricity or anything else? Now, there's one big difference, obviously, which is that utilities can charge you more for electricity in the summer if you're going to run your air conditioning and try to get you to moderate your demand. And we don't really want hospitals to charge people more when there's an epidemic. In fact, we want to make sure that it's free then. So some of the tools of economic control aren't going to be available. But the basic question, how do we prepare for the once in 50 years, the once in 5 years, and the once every day, so that the right amount of capacity in some economic sense is justified, sounds to me like the next step in analysis that somebody ought to be taking.
Do I have to answer that? I think you're correct, but in fact, well, 2 points. One, I think there has been work done on that. If you look at the Millennium Development Project, that I think they tried to look at least, Macroeconomic Commission for Health, tried to look at what overall cost and benefits could be to ramping up health systems. And so they did try to look at some of that. Also, in, for individual diseases, there have been lots of attempts to look at economic cost associated with not responding to HIV/AIDS. In fact, that's been quite effective, I think, in HIV/AIDS, though perhaps the analysis weren't all that good, but still arguing that you save money by responding. So I think there has been some of that. But one of the real problems there is it seems to assume, and maybe I'm being a cynic here, but it seems to assume that we do what's good for us if someone can convince us it's economically good in the long run. When, in fact, I don't think that's usually the way it works in how we decide spending. I agree with you that it's something there needs to be more work done on, but I think in part people haven't found that to be a very effective way to push policy, is to say the long-term benefits are ramping up. Now, in terms of the issues about how much excess capacity would be financially or economically feasible, you want to, I agree that would be a good analysis to do, but I really don't know of what kind of work like that's been done.
Well, in a sense, you're asking a different question, which is how frequently are we going to have pandemic flu? And people are saying, well, you know, maybe another 100 years, and kind of blowing it off in terms of any acute need for dollars, et cetera, et cetera. And the truth of the matter is when you look over the last 25 or 30 years, man, we've got more wacko things coming out of the woodwork than the man in the moon. We've had HIV, AIDS appear. We've got pandemic flu we're working about. SARS, which looks like it comes from bats, you know, in China based on the latest data. We've had Lyme disease emerge in the United States. You know, everybody was worried about herpes in the 80s. Now it looks like it's just like the common cold compared to these things. I mean, I'm just trying to make the point that we have a lot of real risks. And when we look at an individual disease, we tend to become, we're tending to focus on sometimes the tree and not the forest in terms of these issues. And I don't know what the answer is in terms of how many hospitals we need to take care of people that are sick with pandemic flu. I can't say that if we had better surveillance and monitoring and we had a better idea about the routine stuff that was going on, that would serve all those goals. And, you know, when you work internationally, one of the things that you're impressed by is people are really focused on these things because it kills a lot of them. You know, I just got email from a student of mine, not a student of mine, but a student that we're corresponding with in Tanzania on a global health discussion board. And he said something that was unbelievable. He said, poverty is Katrina, HIV/AIDS is Katrina, and child mortality is 9/11. You know, I mean, this guy captured that. And in many of the countries that I go to, they're focused on this stuff because they've got to. And they can't focus on how many hospitals because they can't afford to build hospitals. But they can make sure that at the local level, the water treatment is reasonable. They can make sure there's enough latrines. And, you know, that's actually where, you know, that's where the money is. It's a lot of that stuff.
The question over here, and then we'll get to you, sir.
The last panel, Jennifer Brooks, Gannett News Service. The last panel made it pretty clear that if and when the global influenza pandemic comes, vaccines aren't going to save the population, Tamiflu is not going to save the population. This panel seems to have the skill set that might have a better idea of what practical steps we need to start taking now to prepare. What sort of infrastructure do we need to have in place? Latrines, things like that. I was just wondering, from your experience dealing with the everyday wallpaper horrors in other countries, what does this country need to do? What can we do?
Well, just to take an initial crack at that, I mean, you know, you wash your hands and you cut transmission of a bunch of diseases. Now, flu is very catchy, but nonetheless, you can actually make, you can have an impact by doing that stuff. Well, people in the United States have forgotten how to wash their hands because our food is clean. You know, they do these studies going into bathrooms where they look at how many people wash their hands. Turns out men are not as clean as women. When I work in the developing world, everybody is incredibly careful about washing their hands. And they're incredibly careful about food safety. And here people are kind of lax about it. And I think that that's a sign of how protected we are by the systems that we have in place. I am not as pessimistic as others that things like people understanding the value of quarantine, the understanding of washing their hands, of not, if they've got a cold, quote unquote, that might be the flu, not going out in public. I think that a lot of those things can get across. And those things have to be done at the local level. You can't really have a national figure stand up and say that. I mean, it might help to have Bono say it, but nonetheless, it's all going to be done at the local level.
Let me be concrete as well in terms of the things that we know how to do and the world is really prepared to do with adequate resources. First, starting with the children, if we got every child or virtually every child in the world fully vaccinated to protect them from the vaccine-preventable diseases, if we made sure that every child suffering from diarrhea, because it'll take a while before water and sanitation globally is improved, has access to oral rehydration packets, cost 10 to 20 cents per packet. You mix it with water, and it keeps the child from dying from dehydration. If we made sure that every child with pneumonia or other bacterial sepsis, but pneumonia is the most common, has access to simple antibiotics, we're talking 25 to 30 cents per treatment course. We're not talking big bucks here. If we made sure that every child and adult suffering from malaria had access to effective antimalarials, and that's a shifting field, but we know what works and where they work. If every child slept in a malarious area, slept under an insecticide-treated bed net so that the malaria-carrying mosquitoes couldn't get to them. If every child was exclusively breastfed from birth, and all children who needed supplements like vitamin A had those provided regularly, that's 2 cents per 6 month dose of vitamin A. We're not talking big bucks there. Those are the interventions that we just heard would save 6 million lives a year. It's an organizational challenge. It's not that you fall out of bed and these things happen, but with resources and serious commitment, this could most definitely be done. And then you take it to the next level, which is the non-child diseases. First, you need to make sure that all women and all families have access to reliable contraceptives, voluntary contraceptives, that anyone with TB can get treated. That's $20 a year for a full treatment course with TB that kills 2 million people. And you make sure that there's both good education and good condom availability for people living in high HIV prevalence areas. And then you get into some fairly pricey stuff by global health standards when you get into antiretroviral treatment, but even that now has become the costs have dropped to about $240 a year for ARV treatment, and that's starting to become thinkable, which it wasn't 10 years ago. So that list, it's not a short list, but it's also not 1,000 things. We could deal with 80% of the global health issues and build the infrastructure and the capacity and the willingness to respond to unusual circumstances like an outbreak of the next influenza, whether it's H5N1 or something different.
Question over here. I'm sorry. Yeah, we'll take this guy here and then we'll go to you, sir.
Just to follow up, Mike Dorning, Chicago Tribune, for Dr. Baudelaire, and maybe others would comment on this. Perhaps I'm overly cynical about your cost estimates, but I spent some time in the third world, probably not as much as any of the people up on the panel. But when you're saying 10 or 20 cents for oral rehydration packs, does that include the cost of actually getting it out to the places and bottles of clean water to drink it with? I mean, when you say $10 to $20 for a course of TB treatment, are you including someone who's teaching people how to use the stuff and following up and making sure they use the stuff? In other words, these figures that we're hearing, like $5 billion or $6 billion, does that really reflect the true cost of actually getting the job done, or are you just talking about the, you know, physical ingredients without the cost of a public health system that will deliver it. I mean, I've worked in countries, you know, I can't even get paying lots of money 24-hour electricity. I mean, to you know, with generators and stuff, you still got to let them cool down and things. How are you going to keep all these vaccines refrigerated while you're transporting them all around these countries? I mean, I don't see a lot of cheap refrigeration trucks in places I've been. I'm just wondering if this cost estimate is really real.
That's a terrific question. I'll let the $5.1 billion figure be handled over there. But let me address the root of your question. Yes, you're absolutely right. I'm telling you the marginal cost of the drug, the vitamin A capsule, the oral rehydration. There is a systems cost. The thing is, the systems cost is not huge. I worked and lived for years overseas in Nepal, which is one of the world's poorest countries, and in a very remote area of Nepal, which had literally no health services available to its people. I helped to design and carry out a program aimed at childhood pneumonia that cost total, systems cost everything, about $1 per person per year. Reduced child deaths overall in the district by 28%. And once the system was in place, then we started adding things like vitamin A and so forth. And at that point, that truly was just a small marginal increment. So we're really not talking about breaking the bank with this. Yes, you know, you're absolutely right. When we talk about 2 cents or 20 cents or 25 cents, that's on top of the basic infrastructure. But with trained people and a very limited physical infrastructure, you don't need high tech or hospitals or even doctors for the vast majority of these things. You can do it at reasonable cost. Do you want to add to that?
Yeah, just quickly, you're absolutely correct. I mean, is $5.1 billion include all the different things? No. But one of the things about the approach we took in this is we did include some things that related to system cost in terms of training, supervision. We don't include things like building better highways or building better roads to get things. We included some cost for maintaining facilities, but one of our assumptions, and when we're doing this, is kind of what Neil's laid out. We're assuming all the interventions we were looking here for saving two-thirds of the child deaths are things that can be delivered at community-based levels. So we weren't talking about building new hospitals. We weren't talking about, so there are some additional system costs, but in fact, I don't think you're going to find that it would scale the cost dramatically. But let's say it doubles it. So instead of 5.1, let's say we do need more systems and we double it, and it's $10 billion a year. I'm perfectly happy with that, and I still think it's an affordable price. But I don't think it's not like we ignored that and tried to completely lowball and say, here's this small example. We did try to look at a system that we thought could be implemented for that level.
We have a question over here, please.
Art Chimes from Voice of America. We heard about how the U.S. public health system has been hollowed out. We saw it, a lot of us, firsthand or on our television sets with Katrina. But I wonder how the United States, which does not do very well in terms of longevity, stacked up against other developed, industrialized, wealthy countries, how the public health systems in some of those other countries compares to ours, and what lessons we might have to learn from them.
Well, that's an easy question, actually. Many countries have a much more comprehensive and better funded public health system. You find countries like Cuba, you know, that have lifespan data and infant mortality better data that's as good or better than ours. So it's not often a matter of needing a lot of money to do this. You just have to be organized. The political will has to be there, et cetera. Many, many other countries have much better public health related statistics like longevity, infant mortality, et cetera, than the United States. And these are countries that are not as wealthy. The examples are just, you know, there's tons of them. So I think this is really a matter of us having the political will to address our own issues and to be willing
to be open to learning from what we see sometimes internationally. I think that many people that are in the trenches doing public health, they know this. It's a matter of getting the populace and the political elite to focus on this as well.
There's a very interesting, what we call in epidemiology, a scattergram, which lays out life expectancy on one axis and per capita income on another. And the United States, along that axis, obviously the richer you are, the better you do in terms of health overall, but the U.S. is below the curve on that. And I'd say in terms of affluent industrialized countries, the United States is probably squarely in the bottom third in terms of public health infrastructure and response. Now, that's not to say that there aren't a lot of countries, most of them poor countries, that are a lot worse off and where the public health infrastructure is virtually non-existent. But it's quite remarkable how much variation you see at similar income levels, depending on whether these countries have prioritized basic public health. And that's not the same thing as building fancy new cancer hospitals. It is really looking at what most people are suffering from and dying from and addressing those at the most peripheral level possible.
Got a question over here.
Maggie Fox of Reuters again. As you can tell, I'm struggling for a peg for a story to get it past my editors. And despite the worthiness of talking about 11 million children who die every year, they're going to go, so what? So I've got to get a peg for this. So can we say something like, we can't do anything to prevent avian flu if it comes 2 years from within the next 2 years. But what we can do is save 11 million kids. Can somebody say that?
You know, Maggie, we've had this conversation before, and we really can't do anything about stopping avian flu if it happens in the next 2 years. But we can save 6 million lives of young children a year, starting next year. And we could probably make a very big dent in terms of the basic response capability of the entire world if avian flu or its next cousin holds off another 5 to 10 years.
Any other reporters needing to deal with editors? More than welcome to seek advice from us. Yes.
This is not a reporter question, even though I am a reporter.
But you got to identify yourself.
Brenda Wilson with National Public Radio. You were talking about, you know, the disparities and, you know, the comparisons between developed countries in terms of longevity and in comparison with the U.S. I guess my question would be, because at the same time we had Katrina happening, you had several instances in France, for example, where you had large apartment fires in which African immigrants were killed. And the conditions of those families living in those apartment buildings became, you know, highly public at the time. And I guess my question is, when you look at, you know, the health indices for many of these developed countries, I think, aren't there other issues you have to also take into consideration, such as immigration policies, very restrictive practices, so that you have fairly homogeneous populations and therefore much more of a willingness and a kind of systematic way of dealing with health issues, because you just simply lock out people, you know, that your government may not be that willing to respond to or care about or take care of?
I think that's a terrific question, Brendan, and I think you're largely right that some of the differences are explainable that way. There's no question but that heterogeneity and marginalization, in other words, having a very mixed population, you get far greater swings in terms of the health status of different parts of the population, and it tends to drag the mean down so that highly homogeneous populations like Japan, for instance, which has, I think, still got the world's longest life expectancy, or it may be someplace in one of the reasons is because they have a very homogeneous population. But another reason that you can separate these things out, and there are statistical ways of doing this. There are countries with a high degree of heterogeneity, but with relative equal access to basic essential health services, and their data is always better than places where that access varies a great deal. So we can't deal with the social determinants directly, but we can certainly deal in a public health sphere with response, and we're not doing enough in this country.
It always concerns me as a public health reporter that the public health community so focuses upon the public health prescriptions that the social determinants somehow become second place, and I wonder if you'll ever solve the public health problem if you don't look at the larger social determinants, as it were.
I couldn't agree with you more, and it's one of the reasons that global public health professionals are generally quite active in terms of the social and political and economic side of things as well.
Just to follow up on your point, it was a few years ago in the New England Journal of Medicine, there was an article that received a lot of press play at the time, that men in Bangladesh, and Bangladesh is a country that is very challenged, men in Bangladesh had a longer average lifespan than men in Harlem. You don't have to go overseas to find circumstances that are grim. You can just walk three blocks from here, you know, that kind of thing. So one of the things about the perspective that I think that many of us are trying to enunciate is that global health is indeed global. It doesn't mean a focus on foreign things, and it doesn't mean a focus on domestic things. It means having a comprehensive view. And I think that's really critical.
Other questions? Comments? All right, good. This has been a terrific discussion. I appreciate the comments of the panelists and of everyone in the audience as well. I've always found public health perhaps the most fascinating and complex and exciting and frustrating subject in the world. Let me tell you what we're going to do now. I want to introduce Larry Klein, who's the executive producer of RX for Survival. We're going to see some preview clips that I believe have not been seen before. And then we're going to have lunch, which is in the back of the room now. And then we're going to have a discussion with a panel of journalists and all of you who are working journalists or you're honorary journalists for the purposes of this program to deal with the coverage and the communication of these public health issues to the public. So I'll introduce Larry Klein now, and then we'll see the clip, take our lunch break, come back, have our panel discussion. I think this has been and will continue to be, just a terrific discussion. Larry.
Hi, thank you all for coming this evening. Whatever it is. It's morning now? I don't know. It's just been a long project.
We have to work on Larry.
The I don't know how to get editors interested in this subject except to try to get as many people as possible interested in the subject, because editors sometimes listen to people whose clamor for certain kinds of news. And this event today is one of many that this project is trying to organize all over the country, not just for the press, but for many, many, many groups of people, from college campuses to local Girl Scout gatherings and things of that sort. We really are trying to raise the banner of global health and get people more interested in it. Our goals for the series included taking on as many of the most important issues in global health as we could, and to show that real progress is possible even when conditions appear to be very, very dire. In place after place we went to, we just found extraordinary people working on the ground, making things happen. in ways that I think most Americans just don't realize. It was also very important to us to have Americans see people in the developing world not as the kind of statistics we've been hearing this morning when we talk about, oh, it's a million dead or 6 million or whatever, but as individuals. And I have to say, in case after case after case, almost always individuals of extraordinary dignity, despite the conditions they are living under. Finally, we wanted to show the interconnectivity between global health and our health, something that does bubble to the surface every time a new bird flu type crisis emerges, but then quickly subsides and goes away. You know, the fact is that there are so many levels of interconnectivity between their health and our health, or our health and their health, some are extremely subtle, difficult to understand, but in the end, we do share this planet, and everybody's fate on that planet is our fate. One of the things that was brought up this morning, this notion that Mike raised about how had we looked more diligently 20 years ago at things like the emergence of bird flu, we might be far better prepared to deal with it right now. Well, we could, and I'm sure many people on the panel could talk about that situation being for a number of diseases and conditions that exist. In the clip you are about to see, we will see that issue pretty clearly. It is from the film we call Rise of the Superbugs. Prior to the scenes you are about to see, Paul Farmer and Jim Kim, working through their Boston-based organization, Partners in Health, have been in Lima, Peru, in the slums of Lima, where they are alarmed that patients in a model TB program are taking they're called DOTS drugs religiously, but many of them are not getting better. And Farmer and Kim do not believe it is because the patients are just not taking their drugs in the right way. They believe that they have contracted a dangerous strain of tuberculosis, and they have smuggled, taken those samples from patients back to their labs in Boston for analysis, and that's where this clip begins.
In 1995, they send the bacterial samples from several Carabao patients to a state lab in Massachusetts. The results are chilling. Most samples are resistant not to one, but to all five antibiotics normally used to treat TB. As Kim and Farmer suspected, it was not the patients that were the problem, but dangerous strains of multi-drug resistant, or MDR TB.
¿Se te hincha la barriga?
That is why Raquel is not getting better. The DOTS drugs are useless against her highly resistant TB.
Muy bien, Raquelita.
Now more than ever, she fears infecting her son Bruno. But all she can do is try not to breathe on him.
My son wants to play with me and kiss me, and he does not understand what's going on. He thinks that I am mean, that I don't love him, but I always tell him that I am sick, that I can infect him. And he says, it doesn't matter, you can. It doesn't matter if you're contagious.
Although she fears spreading the disease, there are days when Raquel has to go to the market. Everyone around her is at risk.
It's really a crisis. It's not as if these patients with active MDR-TB were being put in sanatoria. They weren't being removed from the community. They were right there, sick with an infectious disease in a big crowded city.
If the epidemic isn't stopped, it will spread beyond the city or even the continent. Worse, these deadly strains could easily become untreatable.
The notion that you'd be sitting on an airplane, even if you're in first class, and become infected with a disease that could kill you and that modern medicine could do nothing about is very frightening.
Kim and Farmer believe the MDR-TB patients can be cured, but they will have to convince Peru to provide entirely new drugs and more aggressive treatment.
And we went to the authorities and said, we'd like to start treating these patients. And at first, they said, you will not treat these patients. And we said, not treat the patients. We just couldn't understand why. In fact, it was much worse than that. They said, if you start treating the patients, we'll look at your papers and we'll kick you out of the country.
The problem is, the few drugs that cure MDR-TB are highly toxic and cause dangerous side effects. Rarely used, they are so expensive, the Peruvian government can't afford them.
The price of treating MDR patients was so high, it was impossible for us. It was not only an economic problem. The treatment was too complex and difficult to manage. We couldn't justify the investment.
Even the World Health Organization agrees. In the 1990s, the official policy around the globe is to treat those with curable TB and let MDR victims die.
And we thought, but that's not public health. That's sort of like public death. And I said to Paul, it's really important that we do this, because if we show that we can treat drug-resistant TB, we would make the case that these complex health problems for poor people are things that we're just going to have to deal with. You've got to treat people with MDR-TB to prevent it from spreading to others.
If you want to know how the story ends, you're going to have to watch the series, which, just by coincidence, I'm here to tell you when it's going to air, which is November 1st, 2nd, and 3rd on PBS from 9 to 11. There are six programs. They're run two a night from 9 to 11 in two-hour blocks. What Farmer and Kim accomplish in Peru, I will tell you the end of the story, is they do manage to cure these patients, and no one said they could do it, and in fact they said you can do it, and they did, and they were so successful that the World Health Organization has now changed its policy about treating MDR-TB patients. Unfortunately, they're far more people not getting treatment in the world today than are getting treatment. And this is a real problem, since one-third of the world's population now carry the TB bacillus in their body, and there hasn't been a new TB drug created in 25 years. So these are the kinds of stories and issues we will be presenting in the series. These are the kinds of stories and issues we would like to see journalists begin to cover. They are happening right now, every day, all over the world. And I'm not just talking about the bleak side of things. I'm talking about things that, like what Farmer and Kim accomplished. I would like to also add that the voice you heard as the narrator is our series narrator, Brad Pitt. Brad has been a wonderful collaborator with us in the series, very, very, very much wanting to get global health on a higher plane of U.S. priority, as do we. So thank you all for coming to watch with us. If you have any questions about the series, about RX for Child Survival, which is our impact campaign. You've heard a lot in this previous session about the number of preventable deaths that can happen fairly easily around the world. We have created, helped create with CARE and Save the Children, an impact campaign to do just that, to supply those five critical interventions that children need to make it through to age five. And Nanda especially is here to answer questions about our campaign, which we are very proud to say is connected to this project, as are many, many other events like this one. So again, thank you very, very much. If you have any questions about the series, you can talk to me. Some of the people you've seen today, Nils, Mike Osterholm, are in the series along with many, many other very prominent people. Thank you very much.